Hello, and welcome to today's webcast, Supercritical CO2 to support the research and development of cosmetic products, presented by Waters. I'm Rachel Grabenhofer, Managing Editor of Cosmetics and Toiletries. Today's presentation is on supercritical CO2, which is an interesting solvent in many respects. It's safe to use, it's cheap, it's available in large quantities, and it's miscible to most other solvents. Its use as an extraction solvent for naturals with supercritical fluid extraction is well known. In addition, its use as a chromatographic elutant to analyze cosmetic compositions or to purify actives with supercritical fluid chromatography is gaining interest. In this webinar, the principal features of supercritical CO2 will be explained and illustrated with many examples applying to the cosmetic field. Our presenter today is Dr. Professor Carolyn West, who lectures at ICOA, a Waters Center of Innovation, at the University of Orléans, France. She was recognized for her work by LCGC in 2015 as an emerging leader in chromatography. She was also named among the top 40 under 40 by The Analytical Scientist in 2014. She obtained her master's degree in analytical chemistry at the University of Paris 6 and her PhD in chemistry at the University of South of Paris. Before I turn things over to Dr. West, I have a couple of housekeeping items to mention to help you make the most of this webcast. First of all, questions. You'll have them, so feel free to submit them during the presentation via the Q&A box. Dr. West will make every effort to address your questions at the end. Other resources. Our innovative user interface allows you to customize your experience, so configure it whatever way you want for your best experience, and at the end, or even during it, share this webcast with your colleagues and friends via the social network icons. That's it. Now let the learning begin. Here's Dr. West.
Thank you, Rachel. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for attending this webinar. Today I will tell you about the many uses of supercritical CO2 for cosmetic products. Let me first thank Cosmetics and Toiletries to host this webinar. Most of the works I will be presenting today were produced by the Institute of Organic and Analytical Chemistry, a laboratory belonging to the University of Orléans, France, and supported by the French National Center for Research. Basically, the story I want to tell you today is composed of four major chapters. As an introduction, I will tell you about supercritical CO2, which will link all four chapters in this presentation. In the first chapter, I will tell you about the chemical analysis of cosmetic formulations and ingredients using supercritical fluid chromatography. In the second chapter, I will show you how supercritical fluid extraction can provide highly selective extraction of target molecules from natural products. In the third chapter, I will show you how preparative supercritical fluid chromatography can fractionate the extracts obtained from natural products. And finally, I will show you how supercritical CO2 can be used to impregnate cosmetic silica with bioactive components for cosmetic formulations. Please remember that you can submit questions in the Q&A box whenever you want, and if I have not answered them in the course of the presentation, I will try to answer them all at the end. Before to start with chemical analysis, I will answer the first question probably rising to your mind. What is supercritical CO2? On this figure, you can see the state diagram for neat carbon dioxide. The x-axis represents increasing temperature. The y-axis represents increasing pressure values. At the bottom of the figure, when pressure is low and temperature is high, CO2 is a gas. At the left of the figure, when temperature is low and pressure is high, CO2 is a liquid. The diagonal line at the bottom left is the equilibrium line, where both gas and liquid exist. But when you increase temperature to 31 Celsius degrees and pressure to 73 bars, which is a little above 1000 psi, you will reach the critical point. Beyond this point, equilibrium no longer exists between the liquid and the gas. CO2 is a supercritical fluid, a fluid that is intermediate between a gas and a liquid. Interestingly, the critical values for CO2 are particularly low. You do not need to heat up the system very much, nor need to apply very high pressures to reach this point. Thus, the CO2 supercritical conditions are rather mild. Now, why do we like CO2 so much? One first reason could be because it is not flammable, obviously, as you can find CO2 in fire extinguishers. Also, CO2 is available in large quantities. Indeed, CO2 supply is abundantly furnished by most industries, thus it only needs to be condensed and packed into gas cylinders. Third, because of this abundant supply, CO2 is rather cheap. This is an interesting point if you consider using it for industrial processes and not just at lab scale. Fourth, the toxicity of CO2 is low. Yeah, I know precisely what you think at this stage. What? Low toxicity? But CO2 is bad for our planet. Yeah, okay, you are not totally wrong. Actually, CO2 is often called a green solvent, which may seem somewhat contradictory to the often expressed opinion that CO2 is a major pollutant. Perhaps I can say something to defend CO2 in this respect. I have calculated the daily consumption of CO2 when operating an analytical supercritical fluid chromatography system. With the usual operating conditions, I would consume about 1.5 kilograms of CO2 per day. Okay, I admitted that I work only 8 hours a day, but even if the autosampler works 24 hours a day, it will not make a great difference. You can compare this consumption to the daily production of CO2 from your car. In my example, I have used the supposedly eco-friendly car I drive every day to go to work and back home. As I drive 15 kilometers, my car produces 1.5 kilograms CO2 every day. So I am not saying that releasing CO2 in the atmosphere is good. I am simply putting facts into perspective. That being said, CO2 toxicity for a human being is indeed very low, much lower than most solvents employed in chemical laboratories anyway. You cannot be intoxicated with carbon dioxide, unlike carbon monoxide. Also, CO2 can be recycled. If you want to operate at industrial scale, you can recycle the CO2 online to limit the quantities released in the atmosphere and limit operating costs. A fifth interesting point with supercritical CO2 is the low viscosity. For analytical chemists specialized in separation science, low viscosity essentially means faster process. In this example, you can compare two chromatograms separating the same two compounds. The top figure is a method carried out in normal phase liquid chromatography. The composition of elution solvent is rather complex and particularly non-eco-friendly, but this was a method described in the US Pharmacopoeia. The bottom figure is the same separation, but replacing the liquid solvent by supercritical CO2 and a small portion of alcohol co-solvents. There are two important points to notice there. The first one is that the low viscosity of supercritical CO2 allows reducing the analysis time by a factor 10. Instead of 20 minutes, the separation now lasts 2 minutes. In addition, the liquid mobile phase was not compatible to mass spectrometric detection, while the CO2-based mobile phase is perfectly compatible to MS detection. Okay, CO2 does not only have advantages. Its major defect is its low polarity. Thus, as a solvent, you may think that its solvating capabilities are limited to nonpolar species. But fortunately, CO2 is miscible to most organic solvents, and even very low portions of a polar core solvent, like 5% ethanol, are often sufficient to solvate most polar analytes. Considering only neat CO2, you can simply play with pressures to increase its solvating power, but it is much more useful to combine CO2 to solvents. This is what I am showing you on this slide. The gray arrow is showing analyte polarity. On the left are rather low polarity compounds like alkanes or esters. These can be conveniently solvated with neat pressurized CO2. But if you are interested in alcohols or acids, it is preferable to combine CO2 to a core solvent. Then, if you consider bases or zwitter ions, you will also need to introduce additives in the core solvent. Additives are usually small proportions of acids, bases, or salts, typically 0.1%. Finally, if you want to reach higher polarities and large molecular weight molecules like proteins, ternary mixtures with CO2, alcohol, and water would work best. But this is still a relatively unexplored solvation domain. Now that I told you all you need to know about supercritical CO2, I will start with my first chapter about chemical analysis of cosmetic products and ingredients. To use CO2 for chemical separations, you will need a supercritical fluid chromatography system. Probably most of you are familiar with gas chromatography, which is working with a gas as a mobile phase. Most of you will also be familiar with liquid chromatography, employing a liquid as an eluent. The SFC system will then be a sort of a mixture between gas chromatography and liquid chromatography, because we will need a gas cylinder of CO2 and a solvent bottle for the co-solvent. Thus, you may view supercritical fluid chromatography as an intermediate between gas and liquid chromatography. On these pictures, you can see that modern SFC systems are most similar to modern HPLC systems. They look like the classical hi-fi tower, although the tower is perhaps a little higher because we need some extra components to pump and pressurize CO2. From an operational standpoint, modern SFC systems are also much similar to modern LC systems. On the left figure, you can get a look inside the system and you will find the usual elements of LC systems. A binary pump, an autosampler, a column oven, and a diode array detector. In green, I have pointed out at the particular features of SFC systems. First, the CO2 pump needs to be cooled down at a low temperature. Thus, CO2 will be pumped as a liquid to allow for efficient flow rate control and mixing to the liquid co-solvent. Then, the high pressure will be settled with the automated back pressure regulator to control the state of the fluid and maintain a homogeneous mixture between CO2 and co-solvent. Now, let me show you some applications. This one was developed in our laboratory in partnership with Yves Rocher, a famous French cosmetics and beauty brand. In this example, we wanted to develop a simple and fast method to quantify caffeine in a skin tightening cream. For this analysis, the cream sample was simply diluted and injected in the SFC system. The analytical method is extremely simple. As you can see from the details on the right, a ultra-high performance C18 column provided by Waters and mild operating conditions with room temperature and modest back pressure with isocratic elution. The analysis time is 2 minutes with a perfect separation of caffeine from most matrix compounds. On this second application, also carried out with Yves Rocher cosmetic brand, we needed to quantify glyceryl caprylate in an eyeliner the analysis method is pretty much the same as the previous one, but in that case, the sample preparation had to include a filtration step to get rid of metallic particles that could otherwise plug the system. What you see on this chromatogram, recorded with UV detection, is that you cannot see the target analyte. From the structure indicated on the top right, you can conclude that glyceryl caprylate is a non-UV absorbing compound. Thus, we had to rely on a different detection mode. In that case, we chose evaporative light scattering detection. On the orange chromatogram, we can now detect the target analyte pretty well, together with other matrix compounds. Indeed, supercritical fluid chromatography is compatible with most conventional HPLC detectors, not only UV or diode array detectors, but also ELSD and LC-like mass spectrometry with electrospray or APCI ionization sources. In these first two applications, only one analyte was targeted. But when many compounds require quantification, the first step of developing the method will be to find the best chromatographic column. Note that the columns employed in SFC have long been HPLC columns, but now some manufacturers have proceeded to design new, ultra-high-performance stationary phases dedicated to SFC use. In this third application, we were looking for a column that would adequately separate UV filters contained in a sunscreen lotion. From these three chromatograms, you can see that changing the column will have a deep impact on the selectivity, thus on the resolution that can be achieved. So for this separation of 9 UV filters, we did finally select this Taurus 2-peak column, which was recently released by Waters, as the one providing both the best selectivity and peak shapes. On the left, you can see the conditions employed for elution. As you see, in this case, the methanol co-solvent comprises 2% water and 20 millimolar ammonium acetate to allow for elution and good peak shapes of the most polar UV filters. This method was fully validated, including interlab validation. On this slide, you can see the separations obtained in the first laboratory in France and the second one in Czech Republic. In the two laboratories, the same SFC system, namely Waters UPC squared system, was employed. In this fourth analysis example, I wanted to show you that SFC is also a very good method for chiral separations, when enantiomeric purity needs to be assessed. In this application, we were asked to develop a method to quantify the minor enantiomer of dexpanthenol. This is a rather polar molecule and non-UV absorbing. Thus, in the literature, we found that it was most often derivatized, then analyzed using either gas chromatography or reversed phase HPLC. In the SFC method, no derivatization step was required, and mass detection with electrospray ionization allowed for excellent detection of the minor enantiomer. In the following example, I simply wanted to show you an ultra-high efficiency SFC separation of surfactants. 20 peaks are here resolved in just above 1 minute, with a very fast elution gradient. Now a few examples with natural products. This one is an application we developed some years ago with Givaudan, a Swiss manufacturer of flavors, fragrances, and cosmetic ingredients. The essential oils of citrus fruits all contain some molecules belonging to the family of furocoumarins. But these molecules are photosensitizing, thus require accurate quantitation in cosmetic products. A simple and fast SFC method, with only CO2 and ethanol in the mobile phase, was developed to allow for high resolution of many congeners of this structural family. Compared to the HPLC method that was in use at that time, the SFC method was a much faster and greener alternative. For the last analysis example, I wanted to show you this nice separation of triglycerides from a vegetable oil. Traditionally, these are analyzed with gas chromatography after transesterification. In our case, no derivatization was necessary. This is a simple dilute and shoot analysis, allowing the resolution and quantitation of all intact triglycerides. To achieve such a high resolution, we need long column length. Here, 75 cm of C18 stationary phases based on superficially porous particles. Long column length can be used in SFC thanks to the low viscosity of the fluid. At this stage, I would like to remind you that you can submit questions in the Q&A box whenever you feel like, and I will answer them at the end. I will now move to the second chapter of this presentation related to supercritical fluid extraction. On this slide, you can see one of the systems available from Waters to perform supercritical fluid extraction. Just like I showed you for the analytical system, you will need a cold pump to pump CO2 and co-solvents. You will need an oven to place the extraction cells. This one can accommodate up to 10 extraction cells, and a pressure regulator. After the pressure regulator, you will need a fraction collector to retrieve the extracts eluted by the supercritical fluid. In this first example, we wanted to develop a specific extraction of phenolic species from halophytic plants. I told you earlier that the composition of the supercritical fluid could be adjusted depending on the target analytes. On this slide, you can see HPLC chromatograms of three SFE extracts that were made from the same halophytic plant. The top chromatogram was obtained with neat CO2. The second one was obtained with CO2 comprising 10% ethanol. A few more polar compounds can be seen at the beginning of the chromatogram. Finally, the bottom chromatogram was obtained with CO2 comprising 10% of a mixture of ethanol and water. In that case, only the polar phenols were significantly extracted, while the least polar species at the end of the chromatogram are no longer there. Thus, you can make the extraction highly specific depending on eluent composition. Now I want to tell you about this nice flower of Kniphofia uvaria, which is also called the red hot poker for its blazing red color. We investigated this flower, which was of interest to LVMH, a French world leader in perfumes and cosmetics. As you can see on the left, oily extracts of Kniphofia uvaria have an orange color due to the presence of anthraquinone dyes. The major anthraquinones present in this flower are aloe emodine and rain. Some slides ago, I showed you the analysis of a vegetable oil. Using the same method, we can analyze the oily extract of Kniphofia uvaria. On this SFC chromatogram, you can see a variety of lipids, fatty acids, monoacyl glycerols, diacyl glycerols, and triacyl glycerols. But you can also see a very small peak at the beginning of the chromatogram, the anthraquinone dyes. Because anthraquinones have a variety of interesting bioactive properties, LVMH was interested in obtaining oily extracts of Kniphofia uvaria that would be enriched in anthraquinones relative to lipids. The Kinon enrichment, here on the y-axis, indicates how the concentration of anthraquinones was increased relative to the concentration of triglycerides when operating parameters were varied. Namely, the bottom axis is showing density variations obtained when temperature and pressure are varied. It appears that density has a rather limited impact on the selectivity of extraction. However, the nature and proportion of co-solvent, indicated on the right axis, allow the extraction of much higher proportions of anthraquinones relative to lipids. Again, this shows how selective SFE can be if you want to target some particular bioactive compounds from natural products. Again, feel free to submit your questions in the Q&A box whenever you want. And if I have not answered them in the course of the presentation, I will try to answer them all at the end. I will now move to the third chapter related to fractionation of the extracts. To achieve fractionation, you will need a preparative chromatography system, much similar to the extraction system we have seen before. The purification can be conveniently controlled via UV or mass spectrometric detection. Such systems are widely employed in pharmaceutical companies, especially to obtain purified enantiomers with chiral preparative SFC. Let me get back to the Kniphofia uvaria chromatogram. From this chromatogram, it would be impossible to isolate anthraquinones efficiently because the peak is very small and not efficiently resolved from lipid compounds. This separation was obtained with C18 stationary phases, much like the ones people are using when doing reversed phase HPLC. However, as I showed you before, changing the chromatographic column will allow you to obtain much different selectivity. Indeed, this second separation of the same sample was achieved with a polar stationary phase, the 2-ethylpyridine, which is a famous chromatographic column among SFC chromatographers, because it is well known for providing nice peak shapes of basic species even without an additive. In that case, it is now possible to purify each of the major anthraquinones from our sample, aloe imodine and rain. You see, preparative SFC is a quite straightforward means of obtaining pure bioactive species. Finally, in the fourth chapter, I will show you how supercritical CO2 can be employed to impregnate cosmetic silica to obtain novel ingredients. For this purpose, we have designed a simple system based on a supercritical fluid extraction system. Like before, we need a pump for CO2 and co-solvents, an oven containing the extraction cell. This extraction cell contains the seeds of Kniphofia uvaria. The UV detector is followed by the pressure regulator. But after the pressure regulator, instead of collecting the extract, the transfer line enters an impregnation cell containing cosmetic silica. The conditions allowing to absorb the maximum quantity of anthraquinones in the porous silica were optimized. On the left of this picture, you can see the white powder of pure cosmetic silica. In the middle, in non-optimized conditions, some yellowish color can be observed. With optimized impregnation conditions, a nice yellow shade is obtained, indicating that the anthraquinones have indeed been absorbed on the cosmetic silica. The latter can thus be used as a novel ingredient in cosmetic formulations. I have now come to the end of this presentation. Of all the things I have said today, here are the ones you should remember. First, I hope that I have convinced you that supercritical CO2 is a user-friendly and cheap solvent. Supercritical fluid chromatography allows for UHPLC-like separations with mass spectrometric compatibility and wide possibilities for both achiral and chiral selectivities. Supercritical fluid extraction is a highly selective extraction method. Preparative SFC can efficiently purify target compounds. And finally, online supercritical fluid extraction impregnation can produce original cosmetic ingredients. With that, I have now finished this presentation. I only need to thank my colleagues who developed all the applications I have shown you today. Eric Le Cellier, Johanna Duval, Lorraine Gourguillon, Maria Kalikova, Élise Lemasson, Siam Kater, and Cyril Collat. Our institute is part of the Cosmetic Valley and the research group of Cosmactives. I also wish to thank Waters for the support received through the Centers of Innovation program. Thank you for attending, and I am ready to try and answer any questions you may have. Thank you.
So, here we are at the live Q&A portion of our event. Thank you, Dr. West, for a very enlightening presentation. We did get some questions come in as we were going through the presentation, so I think we'll go ahead and start with, can SFC be used for fraction collection using a solvent with it?
Yes, absolutely. the example I have shown, we did have a solvent in there, and actually I would advise it because the solvent will be helpful in improving the recovery of your product, and if you do want to fractionate with neat CO2, it's actually preferable to have a makeup solvent, because when you depressurize CO2, it will cool down, and when it's cooling down, the solubility of your analytes in the fluid decrease. So it's best to have a solvent so that you actually favor the recovery.
Great. What about for stevia analysis?
I know no example of it in SFC, but we have done a few examples on natural products that look very close to deterpene glycosides that you can find in stevia. For instance, we have done iridoid glycosides, which are also terpene glycosides, and perhaps one of the examples I find is the closest to stevia would be the ginsenosides. You can find a paper on that from the group of Charpentier from Canada. This was in the Journal of Supercritical Fluids in 2014. So what you want is basically ELSD detection or perhaps electrospray MS. But in the mobile phase, you will need perhaps a bit of water to have a favorable elution of glycoside compounds. Not much of it, but perhaps 2 to 5% water in your core solvent will be greatly helpful.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Next question is, what about triglycerides extraction by critical CO2 method?
I know a few examples of that. I would say if you want to use only neat CO2, certainly you're going to have a specific extraction of the lipids and avoid extracting too much polar analytes with that. But depending on how far you want to go on your sample, I mean, for instance, you work on vegetable oil, and if you want to extract some of the of the other components of the oil, like also D-glycerides, but perhaps monoglycerides, fatty acids, then perhaps neat CO2 would not be the best choice, and you would like to have a bit of core solvent with that.
Mm. Okay. On to the next question. Is it possible to obtain pure, i.e. greater than 99% of lecithin, which is a polar compound?
What was that?
Oh, sorry. Is it possible to obtain pure, greater than 99% of lecithin or phosphocholine, which is a polar compound?
Oh, that's a good question. I've never tried it myself. I know some examples of analytical SFC with phospholipids, so I tend to think that it should be possible. Over 62%, yeah, probably. Again, it's a question of adjusting the conditions, because what you will need in that case is also probably to have not only CO2 and a core solvent, but perhaps a bit of water, and certainly some additives to favor the ion pairing process to elute the lecithin.
Another question relating to silica. Have you tried trapping your impregnation target during extraction before silica impregnation to gain better control?
Not at all. That's a good remark. Basically, the idea was we were going to use the silica silica that we want to impregnate as the trap itself. And so we optimized the conditions on the impregnation cell, that is the temperature and the pressure applied to this cell to make it a better trap. Depending on the conditions employed, you will have the target being only on the surface of the particles, on the silica particles, or what we aimed at and what we achieved was really impregnate inside the silica particles.
Another question. If there was a way to mainstream supercritical CO2, what can be some beneficial attributes? The comment is it seems like it's more like a processing vehicle. Has this application been explored?
Wow. That's a difficult question.
Maybe that one can be taken offline if you like. Dr. West will get copies of everyone's contact information to definitely follow up, if you prefer to follow up, unless you have a comment.
Yeah, probably. I will need more thinking on that one.
I
promise I will answer it, but I will need to think of it.
No problem. Boy, there's lots of questions. This is great. Is any research or testing done on steroid separation, like testosterone and its metabolites, which are slightly polar?
Yes, absolutely. There are two things coming to my mind. One of it is doping agents. You will find some papers from Devi Gilam and Lucy Novakova on this topic. And another one that was from Michael Doué, who worked on steroid metabolites with sulfonic groups, I think, and probably some taurine moieties as well. And yes, it seemed to work quite nicely. So,
Okay. Another question: have you tried mass-directed preparative collection?
Not myself. I know many people doing it every day, so it seems to work very nicely.
A question back related to the silica. Have you tested the stability of the impregnated cosmetic silica, or is this still under research?
This is still under research, actually, yes. This is so far we have achieved a nice impregnation method, but then the ingredient must be tested further, so I cannot answer that right now.
Okay, great. Are CO2 extraction processes cheaper than standard, meaning using solvents, in the industry?
Oh, yes, absolutely. Basically, the system itself will cost a little more than other systems using solvents, but then the operating costs will be much lower because CO2 is cheap. Even if you use a bit of solvent in there, the long-term cost is greatly advantageous with the supercritical CO2.
Okay. Another question, can you please send or name the brand of the equipment for CO2 extraction?
The system we used was water's MV10 ASFE. It's a very nice system, convenient to use. I would advise it to anyone.
Okay. I think you just answer the next then is where to buy it. Your water.
Odors.
Let's see. I think, there's a couple more that just came in. Is there any anti-doping lab doing SSC for purification of steroids in routine, which are going to be analyzed on GCC-IIRMS? Please give the details.
Okay. I know nobody using that currently as a routine method, which is a pity because it should be working quite nicely. We have done it ourselves, using PrEP SFC for the removal of many matrix impurities from samples from. Actually, we were working on cattle samples, not on men samples, but the problem would be the same. So I know nobody using that as a routine method, but they should.
Okay, very good. A couple of others before we wrap it up. We got about 4 or 5 more minutes. Can SFC be used in a regulated environment like GMP?
There is a recent paper from the group of Christopher Welsh showing that with the recent systems, the modern SFC systems, like the ones I have shown today, it is perfectly suitable for GMP environment. The system is robust, it's highly repeatable, and there should be no problem with that.
Yeah. another one is supercritical fluid, can it be used as a solvent for centrifugal partition chromatography?
This is something we have considered doing for a while. I know no example of anybody having tried it because obviously it will impose some more constraints on your system. But yeah, certainly it should be working. There are many papers dealing with the partition between CO2 and a solvent, so it should be useful in a CPC system.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And you may or may not have answered this, but I will read it and you tell me. Which ionization sources can be used to hyphenate SFC with mass spectrometry?
Actually, all sorts of ionization sources that you normally use in HPLC can be used with SFC. That will be electrospray, APCI, also APPI. And in all the papers, you will find that people were using electron impact. But that was a time when only neat CO2 was used in the eluent, which is rare now. I know perhaps about 5% of current SFC users are using neat CO2 as an eluent. So electron impact is not so much in use. It's rather ESI, APCI, and MPPI.
Okay, very good. Most of the other questions relate to the availability of the presentation, which this will be kept on demand, so you can come back and watch it at your leisure or share it. There is a social media share if you want to share it with friends for anyone who wants to watch it on Facebook, I guess. there is another one that came in. Sorry, let me add. We have about 2 minutes, so I don't want to lose you here, but let's get this one in. In the anti-doping applications, back to that one. Are you directly connecting HPLC as injector or purified samples are injected on IRMS? And then it goes on to, is it? Go ahead, please.
Let me think of this one. Directly connecting the LC or purified samples? Samples. We didn't connect it directly. Perhaps it would. Yeah, it could be feasible if you have a trap, like a colon used as a trap, where you can concentrate the compounds before injecting into the IRMS.
Mm. Okay. It then goes on to ask: is it LC-IRMS system? Questioner would like to use it in routine in India.
Yeah, I'm not sure it would work routinely, but yeah, it would need some technological development first. So.
Okay, fair enough. I think that gets through most of our questions. The slides will be available within about a half. Within about an hour to do the download if you do want, you know, the full presentation. But I again like to thank Dr. West for giving us this fascinating presentation today. Obviously, it sparked a lot of questions, and there are a lot of thank yous in the comments. So, well done, and we definitely will follow up after the fact. But for now, I think we will wrap it up and have a wonderful rest of your day.
Okay, thank you, Rachel, and thanks everyone for attending.
Great. All right, take care. Bye.
Bye-bye.